Hello friends, welcome back. Myself Pushpendra Singh, and today we are going to start with our daily current affairs. So today you have 28th of May 2021, right? And these lectures are basically for those who are preparing for the civil services examination. And we are referring the two national newspapers, the Hindu and Indian Express. You can also refer these two national newspapers. Apart from that, you can also supplement your preparation with the help of these lectures. Right, you can subscribe to the channel on the YouTube for those lectures. Alright, so let's begin with the lecture. Okay, first about the Dominica. The Dominica is basically a country. Okay, it's an island country which is located in the Eastern Caribbean Sea. Okay, as you know that the fugitive diamond trader Mehul Choksi, who is currently declared as a fugitive by the Indian authorities, have been recently been arrested in the Dominica. Right, and he was previously before 7 days was in the news that he was basically left his home in the Antigua and Barbuda, right? And he was basically reported missing from his home. Okay, but ultimately he was caught and he was arrested by the Dominica police or Dominica authority, right? As you know that the Mehul Choksi was basically wanted by the Indian authorities, specifically the banks, because he has done certain fraud related to that, and he was also issued the Interpol yellow notice for their lookout, for his lookout for that purpose. Okay, now that Dominica that we are talking about is basically is basically a country. Okay, now that I told you that now that the Antigua and the Barbuda where the Mehul Choksi was basically hiding, right, before that, is also a sovereign country in the West Indies, specifically in the Americas, which lies between the Caribbean Sea and Atlantic Ocean. And when you say about the Dominica is also an island country which is located in the Eastern Caribbean Sea, Okay, but the Antigua and the Barbuda are basically located in the West Indies in the Americas. Okay, now the Dominica that we are talking about is a part of the windward, the island chain, which is consisting of the Lesser Antilles group of island. Okay. Now that we are talking about, the Lesser Antilles is basically chain of the islands. Okay. To conceptualize, you can understand that the Lesser Antilles together with the Greater Antilles and the archipelago makes up the West Indies. Okay. So it's a part of that archipelago. Okay. And Dominica basically lies between, the French islands of, the Guadeloupe as well as the Mérigoda and Bulente to the north and the Matigny to the south. So it is basically lying between these French islands. Okay. And the Lesser Antilles that we are talking about is basically consisting of a long arc extending from the north to south direction. Okay. And it is located in the Caribbean Sea. So Dominica is basically an island country which is located in this Caribbean Sea. The capital is Tarrasu. Okay, and it is geographically, it is located on the windward side chain in the Lesser Antilles. The Lesser Antilles, I told you that it's a long arc chain or a long small island, long arc of the small islands which are located in the Caribbean Sea, which are basically extending from the north to the south direction. Okay. If you see about the Dominica further, it is basically the youngest islands in terms of its origin. Okay, and it is made up of the geothermal volcanic activities when the plate basically thrusting below other plate, and it is evidenced by the largest hot spring, which is also called the boiling lake, right, which is also found over there. Okay, and country is also member of the Commonwealth of the Nations. The Commonwealth of the Nations are basically consisting of those group of the countries, right, which are having some sort of a the British Empire or previously British Empire. So they are collectively known as the Commonwealth because it is a consisting of a political association consisting of the 54 member states which are all former territory of British Empire. Okay, so it is the map of the Dominica that is basically lying in the Caribbean, right, in the Caribbean Sea. Regarding Mehul Choksi, as it's a fugitive, offender who has been declared fugitive by the Indian authority, right? He was also the business person who was currently residing in the Antigua and Barbuda, but currently he was arrested in the Dominica, right, which is a country, or which is an island country in the Caribbean Sea. The Mehul Choksi was basically wanted specifically in the criminal breach of the trust, cheating, dishonesty, right, and corruption, money laundering cases also. All right, and Choksi holds basically, you know, Antiguan citizenship, and he was owner of the Gitanjali Group. The Gitanjali Group that you would be seeing all throughout the country is basically the retail jewelry company, which is almost having 4,000 stores in our country. Okay, so an arrest warrant for that purpose have been issued in connection with the Punjab National Bank fraud case also against Mehul Choksi. Okay, and he was also allegedly involved in the stock market manipulations in 2013. So he has lot of, you know, the criminal cases like cheating, trust breaching, dishonesty, right, and money laundering cases also. Sorry. Next, Indian Broadcasting Foundation. Okay, as you know that Indian Broadcasting Foundation is basically an umbrella body, it's an apex body for the purpose of, you know, it's a unified representative body of the television broadcasters in our country. Okay, this Indian Broadcasting Foundation was basically founded in 1999, and it was almost 250 television channels have been associated with that. Now, as you know that the Ministry of Information Technology basically have modified, you know, the rules related to, you know, some of the, you know, the platforms or digital platforms, right? Now, to cover that digital platforms also, like you have the Facebook, WhatsApp, or over the top, you know, platforms, this Indian Broadcast Foundation would be renamed as the Indian Broadcast and Digital Foundation, right? It is in the line with the regulations or the rules which are issued by the ministry, okay? So that move would bring, you know, different broadcasters and over the top platforms, right, to basically to the under the ambit of the Indian Broadcasting and the Digital Foundation. Okay. Now, the Indian Broadcasting and the Digital Foundation that we are talking about is in the process of forming, you know, a completely new wholly owned subsidiary to handle all matters which are pertaining to the digital media. Okay, and that foundation will also form a self-regulatory body as per the Information Technology Intermediary Guidelines and Digital Media Ethical Code Rules 2021, right, that was notified by the Government of India, right, on 25th of February 2021, right. So, in my last lecture, in my yesterday's lecture, I have explained you about these Intermediary Guidelines and the Digital Media Ethical Code 2021, which was enforced or which were notified by the Government of India. So, to enforce that mandate which was given in this you know, Intermediary Guidelines in the Digital Media Ethical Code 2021, this Indian Broadcasting and Digital Foundation was basically, you know, empowered for that purpose. So here the industry led, you know, your self-regulatory body that we are talking for the digital other, you know, over the top platforms, which are known as the Digital Media Content Regulatory Council, is basically a second tier mechanism at the appellate level, right, which is similar to the Broadcasting Content Complaint Council. Okay, now these new IT rules that we are talking about is prescribe, you know, some sort of a three-tier grievance redressal mechanism that I have already explained in my last lecture for the complaints related to, you know, the content which are streamed on the over the top, you know, the platform that we have discussed. Also, a lot of issues are there. For example, some of the fake news is, you know, the sexually explicit contents are there. Okay, the news which are related to, you know, the communal violence, the caste and sectarian violence were also, you know, rampant among these channels, right? So here it is basically modeled on, you know, the Broadcasting Content Complaint Council, which is basically look into the content related, you know, the task of the TV channels, digital media, right, and all sort of things. All right, and for this side, this, you know, this body would in the process of the forming of new wholly owned subsidiary to handle this digital media. Okay, and it will be a self-regulatory body, right, that will basically regulate all sort of it, you know, digital OTT platforms in our country. Next, the Golden Visa System. See, Golden Visa System is basically given by the United Arab Emirates, right? It's a new system that was introduced in 2019. Okay, now this is not a residency certificate, or this is not a, you know, the residence, or this is not a citizenship certificate, but what is it is, it is a long-term residential visas that will be provided, right, to certain entrepreneurs, to business persons, to you know, to the researchers, right, and to professionals, right, who would like to reside in the United Arab Emirates for the longer period of the time, significantly, say for 5 years, for the 10 years. So it will be a long-term residence visa that we'll be providing to the foreigners to live and to stay and to work over there in the UAE, right? And you don't need any sort of a national sponsor for that purpose, and you can own 100% of your business. So here recently, the Bollywood actor Sanjay Dutt has been received his golden visa from the United Arab Emirates, so he could go for the longer term, say for 5 to 10 years in the United Arab Emirates. He could stay over there. He could work like a business person. He could own 100%, businesses over there. Okay. So this golden visa system is basically essential. The long-term visa that will be provided for the 5 to 10 years to the people, right, who would like to reside in the UAE for the purpose of, say, for the investment, entrepreneurship, right, for having some sort of there is research related works or the medical related work, right, or scientific and knowledge related works. The main benefit is that the UAE government basically, it will provide opportunity to all people, right, throughout the world who could looking for the UAE for their home, right, for the reasons, right, for the purpose of either investment, for the purpose of working over there as a matter of for the longer period of the time, say for 5 to 10 years. All right. So he's a Bollywood actor, Sanjay Dutt. Next, the Switzerland European ties. Okay. So here, what is happening is that the Switzerland is basically a country which is also a part of European Union. Okay. Now, what is happening is that there is some tussle or there is some strain in the ties between the Switzerland and the European Union. Okay. Now, what is happening is that there are almost 120 bilateral deals between the Switzerland and the European Union regarding some sort of agreement between these two blocs or between the Switzerland and the European Union. European Union consisting of the union of around 27 countries. So here some sort of agreement between, say, labor, the entry of the labor into each other's market or some sort of other issues are there. We will be discussing on that also. Okay, so these ties, which are again, in the strained position because the negotiations which was going on between the Switzerland and the European Union have recently been stopped, and Switzerland has said goodbye to those all sort of negotiations with the European Union, right? The European Union would want to have some sort of a agreement with the Switzerland so that it could smoothen or it could strengthen the relationship with the Switzerland with the European Union. So here, the talks which was mainly going on between the Switzerland and the European Union is some sort of issues were there. For example, the full access to the European Union citizens to the Swiss labor market, right, which is the most pressing issue, right, which the European Union was basically pressing the Switzerland to accept, right, to give the full-fledged access to the Swiss labor market specifically from the European Union nations. And this collapse would further hamper any sort of progress between the Switzerland and the European Union. So let me give you a brief background about the Switzerland and the European Union. So Switzerland is basically the Europe's fourth largest the trading partner. So it's the fourth largest trading partner, and it is almost surrounded by the European Union country. So it's a landlocked country, you can say that, right? If you want to have the more information, say around 14 lakh, around 14 lakh, the European Union citizens lives in the Switzerland currently, right? And you could understand that the total population of the Switzerland is only 85 lakh. 14 lakh out of 85 lakh consisting of the European Union citizens. So you could understand, and you could also understand that some of those, the travel also across the border, across the Swiss industries, and European Union is basically the Switzerland's biggest trading destination also. Okay. And the country is exporting, goods and services worth of around 160 billion euros to the bloc for that purpose. So there is a good relationship, and it's the fourth largest, or it's the biggest trading destination for that purpose. It's the fourth largest trading partner. Okay. Now, the relationship between the two countries have now recently been strained over, the 120 treaties which basically define those relationship, right? And some of these treaties basically frustrated the European Union for the purpose for the longer period of the time, because unlike the UK, the Switzerland has access to the European Union single market, right, and maintains the open border with other European Union countries. So what is this you know, this framework agreement is needed, that we are talking about this institutional framework agreement that the European Union is pushing with the Switzerland, right? So it is, you know, the European Union have been pushing for this institutional framework agreement with the Switzerland, and for that purpose, yes, the European Union have been circulating the fact sheet, right, that pointed out, you know, how this lack of this common rules would lead to, you know, the Switzerland losing its privileged status within the European Union, okay, and that lack of this framework accord was hampering, you know, some sort of access of the Swiss air carriers to European Union's internal market also, right? So for that purpose, the European Union has suggesting, you know, that lack of this overarching agreement or this institutional framework agreement could also hamper the cooperation in the labor market also. It could hamper the cooperation in the health sector, education and the research and various other sectors also. Okay, so that is what is happening, and for that purpose, you know, the talks is going on. Okay, now what exactly caused this talks to fail specifically, you know, in the Switzerland context? So European Union have been demanding the full access for its citizens to the Switzerland's labor market, including those seeking the work, and the Swiss Federal Council was against this approach of giving the full access to the labor market, right? As it would have given, you know, non-Swiss citizens a social security rights, right? You know, some sort of a paradigm shift that would be needed for that purpose. Even the migration from the European Union is most contagious issues, specifically in the Switzerland, where currently the Nationalist Party, which is the most populist party, is, you know, having the highest number of seats in the parliament. So even in 2014, when you say that the Swiss people approved, you know, referendum to stop some sort of a, you know, the mass migrations that aimed at, you know, limiting, you know, the European Union citizens in the country. So this is some of the issues that were still facing, right, between the European Union and the Switzerland also. There are a lot of other issues also. Okay, fine. So here you could see the Switzerland, which is a landlocked country, right, which lies in the European Union, right? So you could see that the neighboring countries like Italy, Austria, right, Germany, France, which are some of the neighboring countries of the Switzerland. Okay. Next, you have currency swap. Now, recently, what is happening is that the Sri Lanka is facing, right, some sort of a, the problems with regard to, you know, the foreign exchange, right? So here, there, some sort of a foreign exchange crisis is been going on in the Sri Lanka. To help the Sri Lanka, the Indian government or Indian RBI or Reserve Bank of India have extended already this help of the currency swap in July 2019, right? Recently, the Bangladesh Central Bank has also approved this 200 million, right, the currency swap agreement to the Sri Lanka, right? What is this currency swap? Currency swap is basically a transaction in which, you know, the two parties exchange an equivalent amount of money with each other, right? But with the different currencies. For example, the Bangladesh here, okay, the Bangladesh, okay, the Bangladesh will provide you, the Bangladesh will provide the Sri Lanka in terms of dollar, okay, and the Sri Lanka will pay to the Bangladesh, right, in terms of the Sri Lankan rupees. So here, the repayment will be paid in the Sri Lankan rupees. You could understand that is what is currency swap. So currency swap is basically a transaction, right, in which the two parties exchange an equivalent amount of money with each other, but in the different currencies. Okay, and the parties are essentially, you know, loaning each other, money, and that will repay the amounts at a specified date at the exchange rate. So here, the currency swap is effectively a loan that the Bangladesh will be providing to the Sri Lanka in the dollars, and the Sri Lanka will repay that, you know, that debt with the interest rate in the Sri Lanka rupees. That will basically help Sri Lanka to come over some of the foreign exchange crisis. Okay, now for the Sri Lanka, definitely that loan agreement would be cheaper than from the market, right? And also it will have some sort of a beneficial agreement, like, you know, a repayment date and exchange rate, that will be also beneficial to the Sri Lanka for that purpose. Okay, and that period of the currency swap will also be specified in this agreement for that purpose, and that will be, you know, comparatively much easier for them. Okay, so it is, you know, the first time the Bangladesh basically extending this help to the island country called Sri Lanka, and it is the first time the Sri Lanka is borrowing from the SAARC country also, other than India. India has already helped, you know, the Sri Lanka in that respect in 2019, right? So here the SAARC, that is known as the South Asian Association for the Regional Cooperation, is basically a regional intergovernmental organization, right? Or you can say that it's a geopolitical union of the states, specifically in the South Asia, right? The members of the SAARC is basically the Afghanistan, Bangladesh, Bhutan, then India, Maldives, Nepal, Pakistan, and Sri Lanka. All right. And you must understand why did the Sri Lanka, you know, Sri Lanka did not approach to India. That is the biggest economy in this, you know, in the South Asia region. You know, there is some strained relationship between India and the Sri Lanka over, you know, the Sri Lanka's decision to cancel, you know, this container terminal project in 2019. Okay. So this was one of the tense situation when the Sri Lanka canceled this container terminal project in which India also had a stake. Okay. But it is not that in the last 2019, in July 2019, the Reserve Bank of India also extended this 400 million, you know, currency swap or the credit swap facility to the Sri Lanka, which the Sri Lanka have already, you know, settled for that purpose. Okay. Now, let us understand what was the issue related to this container terminal project, right? Which is something, you know, have strained the relationship between India and the Sri Lanka. So what was happened? It was a cabinet decision in February this year itself. Okay. You know, the Sri Lanka booted, you know, the India and the Japan out of 2019 deal. This 2019 deal was done with the previous government. But what happens is, in February this year itself, the Union Cabinet or the Cabinet of the Sri Lanka have decided to boot away the India and the Japan out of this 2019 deal, right? This 2019 deal was related to the development of this East Container Terminal, right, at the Colombo Port we are talking about. Okay. And it, as you know, that, you know, the Buddhist country called Sri Lanka is basically, you know, opposing any sort of a foreign involvement in the strategic national assets, like, you know, the port sector. So both the India and the Japan expressed, you know, the displeasure at this Sri Lanka's government or Sri Lanka's unilateral decision, right, regarding, you know, breaking of this tripartite agreement that was basically signed between India, Japan, and Sri Lanka. Okay. It was signed by former, you know, the Maithripala Sirisena Ranil Wickremesinghe government, because that was at that point of the time the Maithripala Sirisena was the president and Ranil Wickremesinghe was basically the prime minister of Sri Lanka when this agreement was basically signed in 2019. But this year, right, with the changes of the government, this agreement was basically cancelled. So here, you know, the Rajapaksa administration offered the best container terminal at the port to India and the Japan for the joint development for the new terms, right? That was altogether a different task for that purpose. Okay, so here you could see that the trade of the foreign exchange reserves with the Bangladesh. So Bangladesh is a country, it's a neighboring country of India. So you could see here the foreign exchange on the 9th May 2021 is around $44.25 billion, right? The foreign exchange that we are talking about is basically, you know, is a reserve, or you can say it's assets such as the foreign currencies, gold reserves, treasury bills, right? These are retained by the central bank or other monetary authorities, you know, that checks balance payments or influence the foreign exchange rate of the currency, as well as it also maintains that balance also. Next, the International ENI Award 2020. Okay, here the Bharat Ratna awardee Professor CNR Rao have been recently received the International ENI Award 2020, right, for its research specifically into the renewable energy sources and energy storage, you know, resources, and it is also called the Energy Frontier Award for that purpose. Okay. Now, what we are talking about the CNR Rao, the CNR Rao is also the named as the Chintamani Nagesha Ramachandra Rao, right, who has also awarded the Bharat Ratna, right? He is an Indian chemist, right? And who works mainly specifically in solid state structural chemistry, okay? And he had, you know, almost honorary doctorates from 60 universities around the world, okay? Now, this Energy Frontier Award that has been conferred for his outstanding work specifically in the renewable energy, because he was working on the metal oxides, carbon nanotubes, right? You know, the systems, right, that include graphenes or the carbon, you know, the nitrogen carbon hybrid materials, right, for the purpose of energy applications, right? Green hydrogen productions and all sort of a renewable energy work for that purpose, his work have been contributed. And as I told you that it is also called the Energy Frontier Award. And what is the most important here is that his research, right, which is related to the renewable energy sources, the energy storage would be awarded for that purpose. He's basically, you know, born in Bengaluru, and he was working specifically in this field. Okay, in fact, you know, he has received, you know, a lot of other appreciations for his work, specifically for the photo dissociation of the water, the thermal dissociation, you know, electrolysis activated by the electricity which is produced from the solar and the wind energy, right? And Professor Rao was working in all three areas that we are just now I was talking about, you know, the photo dissociation of the water, thermal dissociation, the electrolysis, right, activated by electricity which is produced from the solar and the wind energy, right, which is also developed very innovative materials for that purpose. Okay, this ENI award, which will be presented on the 14th October 2021, right, during the official ceremony which is held, right, at, you know, the at the Rome, which is attended by, you know, the President of the Italian Republic, Sergio Mattarella. Okay, and this award is basically, you can understand that it is considered as a Nobel Prize in the field of energy. So it has become very internationally recognized, right, specifically in the field of the energy environmental research, right. And it is basically, you know, awarded to those people who is promoting, you know, the better use of energy sources, encouraging the new generations, right, for research, their work specifically in this renewable energy. Okay, and it is also considered a Nobel Prize in the energy research, right? It's outstanding prize. It is also consisting of the cash prize, specifically minted in the gold medal for that purpose. Okay, so here we are talking CNR Rao. Okay, next, non-aligned movement. Okay. Here recently you must understand the non-aligned movement. The India was basically, you know, the founding nation for this non-aligned movement. The Prime Minister or late Prime Minister Jawaharlal Nehru was basically the founder, right, or the co-founder for this non-aligned movement. Okay. Now Dr. Harshvardhan, who is basically the Union Minister for the Health and the Family Welfare, have participated in the meeting, right, with the health ministers of the non-aligned members or non-aligned movement members countries. Okay. Now, this non-aligned movement, which was a forum of around 120 developing countries, right? So you could understand that non-aligned movement currently has the membership of 120 member states or 120 countries, which is also the largest grouping, right? You know, other than the United Nations. And it is also, you know, have been, you know, not aligning with any sort of a major power block for that purpose. Okay. Let me give you a brief background about non-aligned movement. So non-aligned movement was, you know, emerged in the context of, you know, the deal, you know, decolonization, when a lot of developing countries were under, you know, the colonization power. It was followed, you know, during World War II. So in 1955, what happens is, you know, a conference was held that is known as the Bandung Conference in 1955. Okay, that is also known as sometimes the Asian African Conference. And, you know, the attendees is at that point of the time, right, was basically those countries who were recently gained their independence, right? And they were called for, you know, some sort of abstention from the use of agreed arrangements for the collective defense to serve, you know, the particular interest of any big power. Okay, so in that context, you know, of the Cold War that was basically between the two superpowers, between United States and USSR at that point of the time, right? So these non-aligned movement was basically, you know, a movement or was basically grouping that instead of joining these two power blocks of the United States of America as well as the USSR, right, they should instead join together in support of the national self-determination against all forms of colonization as well as the imperialism. So what happens is this non-aligned movement was basically founded in that context, and the first conference that we are talking about was basically, you know, was basically held, right, as also known as the Belgrade Conference. This Belgrade Conference was held in 1961 under the chairmanship of Joseph Broz Tito. The Joseph Broz Tito was basically belongs to the Yugoslavia, right, at that point of the time. The other invitees, right, or other participant in Belgrade Conference was basically the Gamal Abdel Nasser. The Gamal Abdel Nasser was basically, you know, belongs to the Egypt at that point of the time, right? So Egyptian president. Apart from that, our president Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru was also present at that point of the time. Then Kwame Nkrumah, right? That Kwame Nkrumah was basically belongs to the Ghana. He was also part of that one. And Sukarno, the Sukarno was basically belongs to the Yugoslavia. Sorry, basically belongs to the Indonesia. And it was basically under chairmanship of the Yugoslavia's president Joseph Broz Tito, right? Since it was held in the Belgrade, so it was known as Belgrade Conference. Okay, now as a coordination bureau, right? You know, it is also based in the UN, which is located in the New York for that purpose, right? And it was decided that they will not join any sort of a, any sort of a former bloc like NATO or any sort of a powering bloc for that purpose. However, the idea of this non-alignment does not signify that the state ought to remain passive or even neutral in the international politics in that respect. Okay, next you have the Sehat OPD portal. Okay, the Sehat OPD portal recently, our Defense Minister Rajnath Singh had launched this service e-health assistance and teleconsultation portal or OPD portal specifically, right, to the armed force personnel, to the veterans and their families. So this portal would be providing the teleconsultation, the telemedicine services, right, specifically to the persons who are serving with the armed forces, right, veterans as well as their families. So here the most important aspect is what is this telemedicine that will be provided through this e-Sehat portal, right, through this OPD facility. So the services that we are talking about called telehealth or teleservices is basically the delivery and the facilitation of the health and health related services that include, the medical care, the provider, the patient education, the health information services, the self-care via some sort of a telecommunication and digital communication technology. So that services can be availed by registering yourself with that website. Okay. And it is also the final version of the Sehat OPD portal. Okay. That is having some sort of advanced feature for that purpose. The trial version for that purpose is already functioning, since August 2020 onwards. So here it is a final version of the Sehat OPD portal. The trial version was also already functional, and more than 6,500 medical consultations have already been carried out on this beta version of by the services of the doctors, right, which was functional since August 2020. Okay, so here the Department of Military Affairs, the Armed Force Medical Sciences, as well as the Integrated Defense Staff, the Center for Development of Artificial Computing, CDAC, Mohali is basically involved in this production or involved in the development of this portal, which will be providing the OPD facility, telemedicine facilities to the personnel, to the armed forces, as well as the veterans. Okay, so this portal will definitely have reduction the load on the hospitals and the patients, right, and so that they could get a contactless consultation. So it will be providing some sort of a telemedicine or teleconsultation with the help of telecommunications in that respect. Next, the National Digital Health Mission. Okay, so here the Prime Minister Narendra Modi chaired the high level meeting to review the progress of the National Digital Health Mission. So what is that National Digital Health Mission? First, let us understand that one. Then we'll see what was the outcome of this high level meeting that was chaired by Prime Minister Narendra Modi. So the National Digital Health Mission is basically an agency. It isn't simply an agency, right? Belongs to the Government of India, which seeks to provide, the medical identity document to the Indian people. Medical identity document to the Indian people. So this identity document that we are talking would enable the people to use, the Ayushman Bharat Yojana, right? That will basically, which is the service in India's, publicly funded healthcare. So here, under this digital health mission that we are talking about, seeks to provide the medical identity document. So for what purpose? That is, say, for example, for your e-health, right? Then your digi doctor means comprehensive data repository of the doctors, who are practicing and the teaching modern system of the medicine that will have. Okay, then you have the health facility registry, right? That will be a comprehensive registry of the health facilities of our country across the different system of the medications, right? It will also include all sort of the public and private health facilities. Then you have the personal health records, right? In the personal health records is basically some sort of electronic records, right? That is basically related to health related information of an individual, right? And then electronic medical records, it's a digital version of the patient's treatment history, right, from a single facility. So this health information that is being recorded in the facility is stored locally, right, at the facility where the patient was basically registered. So all things are basically a part of the National Digital Health Mission. Okay, now on 15th August 2020, right, on the Independence Day address, the Prime Minister Narendra Modi have launched this National Digital Health Mission, right? And here the digital modules and the registries have been developed for that purpose and it's rolled out almost in 6 union territories. So far, almost 11.9 lakh health IDs have been generated for that purpose. As I told you, that primary task of this you know agency is to provide the medical identity document to, you know, to the Indian people, right? So for that purpose, 11.9 lakh health IDs have been generated, and 3,106 doctors and 1,490 facility have been registered on this platform till date. Okay, and it has been emphasized as a unified health interface, which is an open and interoperable IT network of the digital services or digital health that will be rolled out soon. So it will definitely allow, you know, the users to search, to book, to avail, you know, the necessary healthcare services such as the teleconsultation, laboratory test, okay, and the system will ensure that, you know, that only verified healthcare, you know, providers join this ecosystem. And this interface that we are talking about, the unified health interface, is likely to unleash the digital health tech revolution with some sort of innovation and various services for the citizens of our country, right? So in such manner, you can say that the healthcare infrastructure and the human resources can also be utilized in a more efficient manner across the country. Okay, so here this interface shall enable the public and the private solutions, right, and the apps to plug in as a part of this national digital health ecosystem. Okay, and during that meeting, right, which has been also the concept of this UPI or United, UPI e-voucher, which has been developed by National Payment Corporation of India, was also discussed. So this UPI, which is basically an app, right, which will be developed for the purpose of providing some sort of a digital payment option, would also be, you know, providing, you know, ease in terms of your financial transaction, which is linked for the special purpose, right, with respect to those services. Okay. Next, you have, you know, Lawrence Descartes. The Lawrence Descartes is a name of the woman. It's a name of woman, okay, who have been recently become, right, the first woman, right, who was appointed as a president of the Lowry, okay, the president of Lowry, the president of Lowry in 228 years of the history of that museum. So the Lawrence Descartes was basically a historian and curator, right? And he basically belongs to the France, or sorry, she belongs to the France. And the world famous museum called Lowry is located basically in the Paris. Okay, it is the world largest art museum, which is located on the right bank of Seine. Okay, the right bank of Seine. The Seine is basically a river, which is 775 kilometers long river, specifically in the northern France. So recently, the Lawrence Descartes have been appointed as the president of Lowry. The Lowry is nothing but the world's largest art museum, which is located in Paris. Okay. Now, what is, you know, the most famous with respect to the Lowry? The Lowry is known for, you know, the home of the Mona Lisa. Okay. The Mona Lisa, which is a portrait painting, which was made by the Italian artist, the Leonardo da Vinci. Okay, which is being home to that, you know, particular portrait. Okay, now the Lawrence Descartes was basically, you know, was basically a leading figure to set up the Lowry Abu Dhabi, right, in the capital of UAE, right, between 2007 to 2014, and she was renowned since then. She was known for since then, and she was recognized for her contribution in that respect. Okay, now she was recently been, you know, appointed as a director, right, or the president of the Lowry in these 220 years of the history. First time, right, first woman was appointed as a president for that, the world largest museum in Paris. All right, so she is basically the Lawrence Descartes, who was recently been appointed as a president of Lowry. The Lowry is basically the world largest art museum, which is located in France, Paris. Okay, all right. So that's all for today. Thank you very much. We'll meet again tomorrow. Stay at your home. Stay safe. Thank you very much.